chose TB as our focus, a disease that is 5,000 years old. You can see the Egyptian mummies in the slides. And today, there are 10 million new cases in the world each year, one-fourth in India. And we are in the middle of an aggressive new epidemic of drug-resistant TB. The slide shows India's shame. We have twice the burden as compared to second-ranking China. Let me briefly talk of an effective scaling strategy. What did we do? We chose our focus. Why, how, what challenges you anticipate? Established a low-cost, high-impact model, learned lessons, refined, defined, built partnerships with governments, with donors, with so many others, technology people. We thought of going global, but we worked locally, wherever we were. And then, of course, a measurable impact is a very important part of a scaling strategy. So first things first in the model, identify the challenges. Why? What do people need? The biggest challenge was daily or alternate day medicine for 6 months, inaccessible centers. How do people work, get work and wages if they have to go for TB treatment? The other challenge was the stigma. People in denial, people losing jobs, homes, families, huge economic loss, entire families sinking into poverty because of TB. Lack of transparency. And by the way, India is the only country where the Health Minister Ghulam Nabi Azad has declared there's rampant fudging in health data. So inaccuracies and data fudging leads to drug-resistant TB because of incomplete treatment. Another challenge is a high cost. You can see the cost of TB treatment ranging from a few thousand dollars to more than $10,000 in the European Union. A high cost program cannot go to scale. So we thought we'll bring down costs effectively and then take it to scale. Our cost for detecting and treating a TB patient is only $80. Now this is basically the model. Provide last mile delivery, the last mile of the cable, so to speak. Fill the gaps in the government's program. No one has to miss work and wages to get the TB medicine. The innovation is that of doorstep delivery. We have strategically located TB treatment centers. What I say, gali gali paan ki dukaan, mandir masjid gurdwari, in clinics of quacks, in temples, in mosques, in small shops. That is where the centers are located. And they are open early morning and late night. And no one has to miss work and wages. They can get the medicines conveniently. In hard-to-reach areas, we have health workers going on bikes, on motorcycles, even on foot, reaching the unreached. In the Mekong Delta of Cambodia, we have health workers going on boats from island to island. It's all about the patient, treating them with love and compassion. But that is not enough. How do you ensure accuracy? How do you ensure the work is done? How do you ensure every dose is taken? Do you rely on health workers? No. With that in mind, in 2009, we collaborated with Microsoft Research to develop e-compliance, the fingerprinting device that tracks every dose taken. It's simply off-the-shelf components, a tablet, and a fingerprint reader, as you can see. Very easy to use, minimal text, color coding, and we've also moved to a text-free icon-based system for zero literacy areas. What happens? These terminals are kept in the centers. Patients come, give their fingerprint, the screen turns green, Shelly logged in, Shelly takes a medicine. But if Shelly's not there, in real time we get to know, and the health worker has to go to the patient's house, take the fingerprint in remote setting, as you can see in the diagram, and by GPS tracking, we get to know that the work has been done. And this is a little bit about our scaling. We started in 2006 in a small rag pickers colony. And rag pickers are amongst the poorest of the poor in the hierarchy of slum dwellers, 30,000 patients. Today, we are serving close to 16 million people in India and Cambodia. As you can see, the tipping point came in 2009, where from 450,000, we moved to close to 3 million people. And what happened at that time? Three things happened. We got the buy-in from the government. Health Secretary Bhopal said, come and work. We have the tribal deaths. We have Saharias. We have starvation deaths here. The TB incidence could be 8 times higher than the rest of the country. We got the donor to fund our program, and we got the technology. So three things coming together helped us to go to scale, and we haven't looked back since then. A little bit about third-party replication done by Columbia University in Dominican Republic, in Uganda, in Kenya. We are collaborating with the national TB programs in Afghanistan. We've opened 20 centers in Kabul. In Tanzania, again with the local government and a local NGO, we are putting 2,600 patients on e-compliance, and the work has already been started. There were many challenges, as you can understand. It's not been hunky-dory for us. So So there were challenges, there were solutions. But I want to just show you the last slide. And that is that what makes a revolution? And I feel a TB-free sandbox will spark a revolution. From Hubli, if we can demonstrate a TB-free Karnataka, that way India can show that we can have eradication in our lifetimes. Thank you very much.
So very inspiring. With this, thank you, Shelly. Our next panelist, Mr. D.N. Kulkarni from Jain Irrigation System. You already heard a little bit of our story, the largest irrigation company in the world and one of the biggest food processor. So I request you, sir, to share a little bit more about the story behind the success.
Jain Irrigation, as you heard in morning, my colleague R.B. Jain, who said that founder started with 7,000 rupees, starting with very small, but you can see the impact. Sun never sets on Jain Irrigation. We have impacted directly about 5.5 million farmers in India, and indirect impact is around 25 million farmers. What is our business model? Why we were able to scale up? It's because it's not just selling irrigation products. It's integrated approach which we have followed. And this integration is solve every problem of the farmer. Do handholding. I think that is the business model which we have followed. And at the center of our activity is farmer. Farmer's interest. What we feel is if farmer is earning more, we can do better business with him. That is the business model. He should earn more. That is the motto behind the business. And this can be done with social responsibility, with environmental consciousness, sustainability approach. And you will see here, what we do is we give farmer a high-tech agri products like irrigation system, tissue culture, greenhouse technology, high quality seeds, agronomic practices, and his productivity increases. If the productivity increases and if there is no market, the prices fall in market and ultimately he doesn't earn anything out of it. Tomato, which were costing earlier 10 rupees per kg, may cost 2 rupees kg if his productivity increases doubles or triples by use of technology. So there may not be a gain. So what Jain Irrigation thought was to do buyback to contract farming. If there is a more productivity, we'll buy it and we process, add value, and we pass on a lot of value added benefits to the farmer. So this is how Jain Irrigation started scaling up actually through contract farming. And it is not just contract farming, it is relationship farming. The model is that we give him a contracted price or market price, whichever is higher. I mean, this kind of contract farming model in nowhere exists. And World Bank recognizes this as a best model of contract farming. There are two major issues with farmers actually. Access to technology, advocacy, learning, and access to finance. These are two major challenges for scaling up. 87% farmers in India have land less than 2 hectares. So it is a country of small farmers. Most of them are not very well educated. They had old mindset of doing agriculture. Lot of resistance to accepting to new technology unless they are convinced. They are very intelligent people because unless they are convinced, they don't adopt. So from that point of view, I think Jain Irrigation did lot of handholding and advocacy. So extension activity is a very big program within company, and access to finance was solved by creating a company called SAFAL, Sustainable Agro-Commercial Finance Limited, a Jain Irrigation NBFC for providing loans to the farmer. So ultimately what we feel is that we should leave this world better than we found it. And this is the motto or mission statement of Jain Irrigation. I will not go into details of it, but what I would like to show is this side. our new approaches in high-tech agriculture. We deal with all these things, new approaches like vertical farming because of land shortage, climate independent cultivation, or what we call monsoon proof agriculture, use of for micro irrigation and fertigation, precision farming, application of biotechnology on very large scale. So there are various ways by which farmer productivity can be increased, and main motto is to increase his income and sustainable income so that the farming becomes profitable in India. I will react when again.
Thank you so much. That's an absolutely mind-blowing success story. With this, I'll invite all our panelists on this stage. Until we're setting the chairs, I would quickly ask Mr. Wilson to, you know, take us to another sphere of life where he, Mr. Wilson is a Mega Sese Award winner in 2016 and has led a movement in India to get manual scavenging totally, banned, which should be, it's not in favor of human dignity and condition. I let Mr. Wilson talk a little bit about that.
Friends, I am not actually the person who can talk about the development as such, because I am with the movement which is actually in the country almost like many decades and the centuries. We were the engaged to clean the human excreta. So that is the reason the community and the self-esteem of the community has completely broken. So we can't even think about the development or the growth or anything which the country is dying or the moving forward. Ours is just actually a kind of a self-respect movement, and this is the only to claim that we are also human beings. It is not more than that at all. Because for us, the problem and the solution is is very clear. So the life, the birth itself is the problem. Just if you born as an untouchable in this country, that itself is the problem for you. And you have to find the solution. It is an vice versa. The problem is the society, the solution asking us to find out. So how we deal this? That is the actual whole thing. I am almost like a 35 years in this, just like that, a journey. There are the thousands of the people are there, not just me. So that is the reason we cannot claim anything as such. But the very saddest part is, even the day which we are talking now, 1.6 lakhs of the women who has cleaned the human excreta by their hands in our country. So how do we come out? There were the thousands lakhs before. It is gradually reducing with the active participation of the many people and the community as such. But still, as of now I am talking, today also 1.6 lakhs of the women cleaned. So what we think about? Then one more thing is, even if there are no dry latrines, we have not invented any kind of a innovation where without the human intervention we can clean our toilets or our flush outs or our septic tanks or our sewage system. No city in the country, not even a single city, can claim that this city is fully covered with the, without the human intervention, we can have our sewage system very safely. No. We talk about many things, but we have not achieved. The problems which we are talking today is that 1,000 years before problems. But we never felt this is the problem as such. And for me also, up to 16 years of my age, I don't know what is exactly my problem. So when I realized that, being a son of the scavenger, how it is difficult to be just to stand, get up, say that I am so and so. Then we started thinking about this. This is the whole movement. So I don't want to explain much about this, but I want to bring to your notice that this is the problem which has never resolved, never given any kind of attention by the society or by any government as such. But the community, now many governments want to do. But at the same time, within 2 years, 1,370 people died in our sewer lines and septic tanks. We don't have any kind of a technology to do that. the same similar way we have a capacity to launch a rocket engines, cryogenic engines, and we have a capacity to launch the Agni. We must feel proud for that. I am not criticizing at all. But the same time, we must have at least a kind of a minute to think about how we can protect the life of the these people who are dying for all of us.
Thank you so much. Very well said. Scale, just for the scale sake, doesn't really mean anything. If it doesn't impact bottom of the pyramid and those absolutely vulnerable, I think all of us would be, you know, just talking about numbers. With this, I come to, you know, Mr. Himanshu, who's come from, is a sarpanch of a Punsari village. And we have 5 lakh villages in the country. I would like Mr. Himanshu to talk a little bit about how he actually went up and made a smart village in a real sense, which is good for not just for, you know, the government statistic to say, but for the villagers themselves. So please, Himanshu.
Thank you. I'm talking about Hindi. Mera gaon गुजरात में अहमदाबाद से करीबन 90 किलोमीटर के ऊपर एक छोटा सा गांव, जिस गांव की पॉपुलेशन 6000 है और करीबन 23 डिफरेंट कम्युनिटी के लोग इस गांव में बसते हैं। 2006 में मैं पहली बार इस गांव के सरपंच यानी कि गांव के प्रधान के दौर के ऊपर इस गांव का चुनाव लड़ा और इस देश में सबसे कम उम्र में मुझे 23 साल की उम्र में इस गाँव के सरपंच बनने का मौका मिला। बेसिकली थॉट ये था कि गाँव गाँव रहे, आत्मा गांव की रहे, फैसिलिटी शहर की हम किस प्रकार से गांव में दे पाए। और एक भी एनआरआई फंड के बिना, कोई एनजीओ फंड के बिना, कोई सीएसआर फंडिंग के बिना, सिर्फ स्टेट और सेक्टर की स्कीम को हमें यूटिलाइज करना है और इस गांव को डेवलप करना है। दोस्तों, इस गांव की सिचुएशन 2006 में ऐसी थी, जब मैंने इस गाँव का गाँव में ही मेरी पढ़ाई खत्म हुई, मैंने हायर एजुकेशन के लिए कॉलेज खत्म करने के बाद इस गाँव में जब जाता था, 20% हाउस होल्ड में टॉयलेट थे, हर 2 महीने इस गांव से क्राइम रेट होता था, पुलिस केस होता था, वाटर डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन सिस्टम नहीं थी, गंदगी उतनी थी, लोग आपस में झगड़ते थे, एक गांव का हाल बना था जो ऑलमोस्ट इंडिया के रूरल एरिया में हमें देखने को मिलता है। दोस्तों, 2006 से शुरुआत हुई, आज इस गाँव में 100% ड्रेनेज है, 100% टॉयलेट है, 100% LED विलेज है, 100% पक्के हाउस होल्ड है, ताकि लोग ओनली ऑन डिपेंड एग्रीकल्चर और मिल्क के साथ है। फिर भी सारी गवर्नमेंट स्कीम्स को हमने इस गांव में इस गांव के साथ जोड़ा, लेकिन मैं मानता था कि गांव में रोड बन जाना, लाइटें चल जाना, ड्रेनेज बन जाना, वो डेवलपमेंट यानी कि स्मार्ट विलेज को स्मार्ट बना सकता है, लेकिन गाँव को आदर्श नहीं बना सकता। मुझे गाँव को स्मार्ट से पहले गाँव को आदर्श के साथ जोड़ना था। और बहुत सारी चीज़ें हम इस गांव में लेके आए, हमने पब्लिक अनाउंसमेंट सिस्टम शुरू की, गांव में अलग अलग डिफरेंट 120 जगह के ऊपर वाटरप्रूफ स्पीकर्स है, सुबह गांधी बापू के वैष्णव भजन तू भजन शुरू होते हैं, गांव में एक एटमोस्फियर शुरू हो जाता है। जितनी गवर्नमेंट स्कीम्स है वो सारी मैं अपनी ऑफिस से अनाउंस करता हूँ, लोगों तक वो सारी गवर्नमेंट स्कीम्स पहुँचती है। इस गाँव में एक PA सिस्टम होने के बाद 100% लोगों के पास आधार कार्ड है, 100% लोगों के पास इलेक्शन कार्ड है, 100% लोगों के पास बारकोडेड कार्ड है, 100% लोगों के पास बैंक अकाउंट है। ये छोटी छोटी चीज़ें लोगों तक पहुंची है। एक अवेयरनेस कैंपेन के लिए भी ये PA सिस्टम हम यूज़ कर रहे हैं। दोस्तों, ये गांव 100% फुल्ली वाईफाई है, ओनली 50 रुपीज़ पे करने से 3 Mbps स्पीड से लोगों को इंटरनेट फैसिलिटी हमने 2010 से शुरू करवाई है। दोस्तों, इस गाँव में हमने ई टॉयलेट्स के ऊपर हमने इस गांव में काम किया है, हमने ई टॉयलेट्स इस गांव में शुरू करवाए, हम डोर टू डोर वेस्ट कलेक्शन कर रहे हैं, वेस्ट कलेक्शन से रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी के ऊपर हमने काम किया, खुद की इलेक्ट्रिसिटी हम जनरेट कर रहे हैं। और आज एक टाइम ऐसा है कि हम गांव सरकार को इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बेचना है की शुरुआत कर रहे हैं, 6 रुपीज़ पर यूनिट के मुताबिक हम गाँव से स्टेट गवर्नमेंट को इलेक्ट्रिसिटी सप्लाई कर रहे हैं। दोस्तों, इस गाँव फुल्ली कवर्ड टू CCTV कैमरा है और इनकी भी पब्लिक डोमेन मैप है, ताकि आउट ऑफ साइट कोई भी इस गांव को देख सकता है। दोस्तों, स्कूल्स हो, स्मार्ट क्लास हो, स्मार्ट आंगनवाड़ी हो, वीडियो लाइब्रेरी हो, गांव का न्यूज़पेपर तक हमने शुरू किया है। प्राइमरी स्कूल के बच्चे हैं 6, 7, 8 स्टैंडर्ड के, वो गांव पंचायत के बाल पत्रकार हैं। और जितने पूरे महीने में जितनी पॉजिटिविटी के काम गाँव में होंगे, ये बच्चे नोट डाउन करेंगे और ये मेरे गांव के पंचायत के बाल पत्रकार, पूरे महीने में एक पेपर लॉन्च हो रहा जो कलाम साहब के नाम से हमने कलाम संदेश न्यूज़पेपर शुरू किया है, वो एवरी हाउस होल्ड हमने ये न्यूज़पेपर को डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करते हैं। दोस्तों इस गांव में इंटरनल ट्रांसपोर्टेशन फैसिलिटी हमने शुरू की है, पंचायत की खुद की ऑन ट्रांसपोर्टेशन फैसिलिटी है जो गांव में ही घूमती है, विमेन को मिल्क बैंक तक ले जाती है, मिल्क भराने के बाद ये बस सर्विस उनको अपने घर तक ड्रॉप करती है। लेकिन दोस्तों बहुत सारी चीज़ें इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर रिलेटेड टेक्नोलॉजी बेस्ड के थ्रू हुई है, लेकिन जो मैंने पहली बात बताई कि लोग गूगल में सर्च करके विश्व के साथ ही कनेक्ट होना चाहिए, और वही लोगों को रघुपति राघव राजा राम और वैष्णव भजन तू तो आने ही चाहिए। हमें अपने कल्चर से जोड़ के हमें डेवलपमेंट करना है, हम उस संस्कृति से जोड़ के हम गांव को एक मॉडल विलेज की ओर ले जाने का प्रयास कर रहे हैं। रिसेंटली मैं स्टेट गवर्नमेंट ऑफ गुजरात के साथ और 1000 स्मार्ट विलेज के ऊपर काम कर रहा हूँ। इस गांव को 2010 में स्टेट का मॉडल विलेज और रिसेंटली प्राइम मिनिस्टर जी ने इस गांव को सेंट्रल का मॉडल विलेज इस गांव को डिक्लेयर किया है। मुझे आप सबसे बात करने में थैंक यू सो मच।
तो ये ड्रीम विलेज, ये बहुत लोगों का ड्रीम है। आई थिंक वी एक्चुअली हैव समवन हियर हु हैज टर्न इट इनटू रियलिटी। व्हाट आई अंडरस्टैंड, जस्ट स्मार्ट इज नॉट इनफ। इफ इट इज, देयर इज नो आइडियलिज्म, देयर आर नो प्रिंसिपल्स एंड वैल्यूज, यू माइट जस्ट हैव लॉट ऑफ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ओनली। So what Himanshu has done for those who cannot understand Hindi is brought not just infrastructure on the floor, but created a development scenario where it's by the people, for the people, of the people, in terms of communication, programs, you know, bringing people online and many such things. So we do have roundtables today at 4 o'clock. Any of those who want to meet any of these people, you are welcome to connect with them later. With this, I come to Chetna ji, you know, which is like another example of creating a bank, Mandeshi Bank, which is for the women, by the women. A wonderful story, an amazing ideal person that I really look up to, a woman ideal. Request you to say in few words, what is the story behind Mandeshi and what has made it what it has become today?
Hi. I never thought that I'll be starting a women's bank. It was a one woman, you can see her film on YouTube, Kanta Bai. She was the street vendor and she said that I want to do savings. And my obvious answer was that if you want to do savings, go to the banks. She went to all the banks. She wanted to save 3 rupees a day and banks were not ready to open her account. I'm talking about 15 years back. And so then when bank said she's not an affordable client, we thought that why not start a women's bank for women like Kanta Bai, and we applied for the banking license. When we applied, our license was rejected because most of our women were non-literate and they had a thumb impression. I was nervous. I talked to women and I said that our license has been rejected because majority of our promoting members are non-literate. I was nervous, but women said, so what? We'll learn to read and write and we'll apply again. And our literacy classes started. After five months, we applied again. But I wasn't sure that we'll get the banking license. So I said, I'm not going alone. These women will accompany me. So we had 15 women with me to Reserve Bank of India, Mumbai, meeting the director. Women said that you rejected the license because we are non-literate. They challenged and they said, tell us to calculate the interest of any principal amount. If we fail, don't issue the license. Tell your officers to do it without calculator and see who can calculate faster. You know, we got the license, but the lesson which I learned was that people can be non-literate, that people cannot read and write, but they can calculate. They can calculate and they can do financial planning. So today with Mandeshi Bank, we are banking around more than 310,000 women in state of Maharashtra, and in other state, we have a finance company. Now when I'm saying, I would just summarize and say that it is so interesting that, you know, bank was started with no business plan, action plan. But when you are setting up a financial institutions, you require many things. But before coming to that, I'll just share one mistake which made us learn so much, and that is that, you know, these women started savings and we provided them boxes because we thought that they won't be, they'll be saving in the coins. But after the box was full, one woman came to the bank and she was crying. Her box was broken, her money was taken away. She said, "You gave us a box, but before your bank representative comes, my husband took away all my hard-earned money." That was a learning for us, that it is not just access to service. It is not just financial inclusion. It is more about having control on finance given to these populations, women and low-income group people. And so then we started a very different journey. And today, I'm very proud to say that in 2006, our women were using electronic passbook. Today, our bank is a member of UID Aadhaar. All our 310,000 women who do real-time transaction, their transaction on the street hit to our system. Every day we do 22,000 transactions, and these are all street vendor women. And we have more than 150 crore of asset size. So these are the women we look for.
Thank you so much. So, so very inspiring. Now the question comes to my mind is that, you know, if we, all these examples actually become reality for all billions and billions of people in India, you know, we wouldn't need another development dialogue. But that doesn't happen. You know, we do all of know, that's why the theme of this dialogue is scaling effectively, that a lot of these ideas are beautiful stories, anecdotes, but then they kind of have only that much scale. You know, I would like to bring, and the sector we are talking about is very different. It's not a corporate world, although I know it's very difficult scaling there as well. There are financial models, there are people, there are already a developed ecosystem. But here we're talking about taking people on board who have a certain mindset, who have certain realities they are situated into, that needs to be taken into account, and that's why you are, each one of you are trying to build with it. So with this, I'll ask each of you to, you know, perhaps say what are the two, three things that are really game changer, your trigger point, that as a problem or as a challenge that you had to overcome in order to get there where you are today. So I'll just begin with Mr. Kulkarni.
Working with so many millions of small farmers itself is a challenge. Reaching them, you know. So this challenge was to some extent overcome. We are not still overcome this challenge. Out of 120 million farmers, we have reached only, you can say, directly and indirectly about 25 million farmers. So only 2% impact. So you can imagine how much still scale is there. So we can scale, but subject to several pointers. And the biggest pointer is how to educate farmer. Apart from Government of India, I think we are the largest employers of agriculture graduates and agriculture engineers. Around more than 1,000 people are working as handholders to the farmers through our own company as well as through our dealers. This is one challenge. Another challenge is access to finance. See, in order to absorb these new technologies, farmer needs to have finance for this. And we had a lot of partnership with government. I should acknowledge here the role of government for providing subsidy to the farmer for drip irrigation. And the purpose behind providing subsidy is we save almost 50 to 60% water. That means we can double the area which is under irrigation. And you know, not only it is saving water, but increasing productivity. And this is very important for India's food security issues in future also. So I think these two challenges can be overcome, access to finance. To some extent, our company is providing access to finance, but government role is much more, providing subsidy.
People here in the audience, the government, people from government, could show of hand. I know one here. I know you're there, Vishnu. So, with access to finance, can I quickly go to Chetna and then see what are the two things you think? Because this is really, microfinance have come a long way, and that's why it's increasing every day, because it's really a great solution and delivers credit at the doorstep. So what are the two things that perhaps has
that you had to overcome? And then what are other two things that you need to, we must, as a microfinance sector, in order to reach, you know, double our impact or, you know, maybe another tenfold? What are the two things?
So one, as far as the question you asked about, is that I feel now very strongly that, yeah, credit at doorstep, fine. But the one thing which is very important is the savings at doorstep, which is so important that unless you do that, you cannot create the entrepreneurial sector richer. And so that is one which I feel. And for that, you require a lot of systems, because when you are dealing with the savings, it's very different in compared to credit, because it's people's money you are bringing in. And in that, I would say that whole design from the street vendor who puts her money in saving, at the time she saves, she needs to know that, yes, money has gone into my account. And how that will happen is that she saves. You have both a technology and the human chain. And those have to be, it has to be effective, and it has to have a compassion, but it has to have a process which is very efficient. And that is possible, not alone. Like for example, how do we do that? Is that we are member of UID Aadhaar, we are member of National Payment System of India, NCPI, and with all that we can do. That is one. But second, I would say, I would just share about, you know, this whole in the phase of demonetization. You know, we do 100 things where we are working with low income group or a bottom of pyramid. One challenge can shatter that community. And that we saw in demonetization. A lot of our women had a bank account, but they had a 1,500 rupees note, which can just become a paper and they can go 3 months, 4 months backward. So how do you deal that? And how do you deal it in such an efficient way? You cannot unless you have systems in the place. And when we saw that, many of our women were saying that, you know, we are ready to sell our 500 rupees for 450, 400, 300. And we were shocked that, you know, these are hard-earned money they have kept for medicine. So how do you do that? And that we actually, I'm just glad to share that we had this business school of wheels, which we started from sandbox program, we converted into mobile bank and provided the pouches to these women of 500 rupees. But when, having said that, we saw that, you know, now what we are doing is that women are ready. I mean, when we talk to women that now you have to do a cashless transaction, it's not easy, but still our street vendors, they are ready to have a smartphone and they are ready to use the e-wallet. I'm telling you, it is such a humbling experience to see that our women are using FT Cash and Paytm, and it's not a matter to teach them. I think it's a matter of us to prepare ourselves, that do we have systems in place, because they are talented. Yeah. It's a matter of us to do that.
Absolutely. So I think it's wonderfully put in words, because, you know, one shot could just get a person off their safety net, which for them it's pretty much a question of survival. But this, I want to come to Himanshu. You know, how did the ideal village, smart village function in the times of vulnerability, as Chetna just talked about? Because I think as India grows, we have to do some lot of disruptive, bold decisions have to come into place. So a little bit about, you know, what does that village look like? How are we preparing? Do you think that Punsari village is prepared today to take on the world and be in the economy just at par with the cities? And then what are the 2-3 things you think you had to overcome to reach there?
Logon ka wahi ki mindset change kare, lekin logon ka system aur logon ke leader ke prati unka trust build hona zaruri hai. Jab leader unka logon ka hai yaar base sare leader corrupted hai, ye to paise hi kha jayenge, chunav jeet ke aayenge, to logon ka trust build hona bahut zaruri hai.
Nahi hota kya?
ट्रस्ट बिल्ड हो जाएगा तो बहुत सारी चीजें जो सोच हम लेके जाते हैं वो आसानी से लोग उसको एक्सेप्ट करना शुरू कर देते हैं. डिमोनेटाइजेशन की बात हो रही है, पिछले 2 साल से 13-14 से गांव कैशलेस है. एक भी पैसा कैश में इस गांव में ट्रांजेक्शन नहीं होता. 100% कैशलेस विलेज 2 साल पहले हो गया, क्योंकि लोगों को जो सोच हम लेके गए कि यार ये करना है तो लोग आसानी से करते हैं कि हाँ लीडर बोल रहा है ये सही होगा. तो माइंडसेट चेंज करने वाली बात है, वो ऑटोमेटिकली वहीं पे आ जाती है, और उस वो आ जाती है तो सारे प्रॉब्लम वहीं से सॉल्यूशन हो जाते. एवरी 2 मंथ इस गांव से एक एफआरआई होती थी, पिछले 5 साल से इस गांव का क्राइम रेट जीरो है, एक भी एफआरआई इस गांव से नहीं हुई। तो मेनली है कि जब ट्रस्ट बिल्ड हो जाएगा तो बाकी सारे प्रॉब्लम मॉडल विलेज और स्मार्ट विलेज में सॉल्यूशन।
So I think there are two things, trust deficit and a leadership deficit that I think all of us face. So we need a leader that actually walk the talk and show people, so it's easier to get onto that path of development. With this, I want to talk to Mr. Wilson. Seems like, you know, similar this thing. It's really the mindset. Begin there and then of course then move on, that this is how we can get out of that condition that we want to get rid of and go towards more prosperous, better, dignified life. So what are the 2-3 things that you had to overcome in order to be there?
See, actually mindset is most important in the caste lens and which we know, but we have to follow the constitution of India. What we have done whole this movement is, whatever our struggle and fight, it looks like we lost, it looks like we have never achieved anything, but it is the only the movement which has strengthened the Indian whole bureaucracy. Indian bureaucracy never respond to the poorest in the country. And the scavengers in certain districts, 864 times they submitted the memorandum to the collector. 864 times. Later, they have to do like. So making the whole government to function by the Safai Karmachari women is the one step. Then second is the judiciary. When we find that we have to go to the court, after 93, there is an act in the country which prohibits the manual scavenging. Till 2003, in the whole of the country, no police station has not punished even a single person. Of course, up to now, we have not punished even a single person. No prosecutions. 2003, when we went to the Supreme Court, 7 women who used to do the scavenging, they went to the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court, 3 chief justices, 28 judges of the Supreme Court, 36 listings it was there. Each listing, the scavenging women, they made the advocates and the judges and the chief justice educated about the actually what is the justice, what is the dignity, what is the constitution says. We don't win the case or anything. It is not the winning or losing. I also felt in the beginning, like by seeing the cinemas and all, so in the case we will lose or win. In the Supreme Court, there is no losing or winning, no. They pass the directions. Likewise, the civil society's contribution also. When we started first talking about that, everybody said, where is the scavenging? It is the rural problem. Some more in the remote. No remote. In the Delhi, even in the Bangalore, we know where it is, the dry latrines. So, it is not the rural-urban problem. So, but now, the civil society, they themselves, they go, they find out where is the scavenger. Coming and reporting. Media, before it was a sensational. We have to come and say that when we carry the human excreta, when the rain comes and during the rain, the excreta will fall here and sometimes it comes here. We have to say so much. Why to say if you are not eating the shit? Making one human being to clean the shit, is it not the crime? So now the society has come to that stage. That is the reason this movement, we never printed even a single poster with the scavenging women who is cleaning. We never showed any documentaries. We never made anything. Because the people's attitude, it has to come to a level, conscious level, up to the standard. Not to show very degrading thing and we get so emotional. So it is not emotional. It is a rights and we have to fulfill that. So, all these women, I feel so proud, who came to the collector office and they thrown the basket and they burned the basket. They said that we don't want to do. It is your responsibility to do the rehabilitation. So, this is actually strengthening the whole democracy and making the whole the society on the track that what needs to be immediately we have to address like. And at last, we went to the parliamentary standing committee. So, parliamentary standing committee is asking us, is the Safai Karmachari Andolan has any solution to clean the sewage system? And we went to the scientist forum. So they are asking, because you have been working since so long, can you suggest any model? So the problem is like, we have cleaned all these years, so even the scientists are asking, you find out the solution, because I cannot. My mind cannot think about the shit. Because it is in a dirty which I cannot. So your mind you have to. So the my submission is the whole the society tremendously changed. Even including this scavenging. 25 years before, when I want to go and talk about this, 35 years before, my own brother and my family members, they said, don't talk this nonsense, you go to the school. Why you are talking about this? My own people said, bata sakte, bol sakte, roti kon dete hai? Oh, sorry. Hindi baag hai, sorry. I from the Karnataka, actually, I supposed to speak. Kannadalli maatadbeku. Avarella nanage helidare, naavu ee kelsa bittidre, namage iga kana kaha se aayega. So what to do? That is the situation. But today, they have changed. And the society changed. This is in a very, 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 a kind of a ray. In the midst of the so turmoil, there is a hope. There are the hopes that the India is not a country which is not stagnated. It has a tremendous capacity to move forward.
Absolutely.
The scavengers will come out of the scavenging by 2019. There will not be any women. That is, we have to take a vote. No women should clean the human excreta in our country. That we have to declare, everybody must take the responsibility.
Well, hats off to you, Wilson sir, because it's our own mind and we have really been status quo, how much, howsoever we like to deny it, because we have our own comfort zone. The kind of problems we choose also have to do a lot with it. So someone to not look away from the problem in front of them, as you said, and not say that's their problem versus my problem. And actually, raise it to a level where we are all on the one side. With this, I want to go to Shelly, because she also chose to look a problem in its eye, which is TB. Although we hear this word and then we brush it off because, it's a past thing. It is not. It is very much a reality and it's a pandemic. It's affecting many more Indians than AIDS is. So a little bit about Shelly, in short, that what are the 2-3 things that led the solution to scale to where it is today, just 2-3 things if you could.
Okay, so just 2-3 things. Let me just say that the biggest enabler for scaling has been the Indian government. Very often we find governments and NGOs looking at each other with suspicion. I think that should absolutely not be the case. We should work together towards a common goal. And in the TB treatment program, we found that the Indian government has divided the country into zones. Each zone has got a TB hospital, free medicines, free doctors, free X-ray chest, sputum, cultures, you name it, and they've got it there. And if we can effectively become the link between the well-intended government programs on one hand and the hard-to-reach patients on the other hand, then we are providing the services to the poor, which are given by the government, and that is all that we are doing, the last mile connectivity. So with this, we have provided a great leverage to the donor. And as I've said before, I feel the donor's money is a sacred trust. You cannot fritter it away. If we were to start buying medicines and paying for tests and paying the doctors who cost so much, it would have been impossible for us to go to scale. So the government has been our biggest supporter. In fact, in some of the areas like Mandla, the government officer said, oh, technology, let us buy our hardware, your hardware. They don't need to buy hardware. They found the money from some program or the other to buy the technology for us because they were so enamored with the results. So that has been a biggest enabler. One of the challenges that I've had to face is the stigma. And I can go on talking about stigma the rest of the day and the program will come to an end, but I'll briefly touch upon it. Ideas are very good. When you go to implement them, there the challenge lies. So the idea was that of opening TB treatment centers within the slums, but the slum dwellers didn't want me there. The same people for whom I had been operating for free for 10 years, when I went to them and said, I want to open a TB treatment center here, they said, no, you'll bring TB here, get out. And I didn't know what to do. I thought of everything in the book and there was no solution. Nobody was willing to talk of TB. They said, you'll bring TB, you'll give us disease. I'm a chaiwala, I lose my customers, and so on and so forth. The solution came from people who had TB. So it's a people's program, Operation Asha. It's not my program. One of them was a priest in a temple. Young, dynamic guy, only 20 years old. He said, I've been cured. I know it's not a curse from the gods. I know it's a bacterial infection. Someone helped me, I'll help others. So the first TB treatment center was actually started, one of the first, in a temple. And this guy was so good, he said, people from the other communities will not come into the temple. I will go outside the temple, I'll keep the boxes of medicine here. I will go to other religion, people from other religions, and give them their medicine. That is how we overcome stigma. And his brother became a health worker to track with patients. When people saw, they were treated like doctors, they're getting income. Anyone who comes to pray will put 2 rupees in the donation box. And their respect is going up. That set the ball rolling. But initially, it was extremely difficult for us. Even today, the stigma is so much. People say, TB, why do you want to work in TB? Once the health workers went on strike, we don't want to work in TB. All over the world, there's no awareness. If there's no awareness, there are no funds. So that is another challenge that we overcome. But if you have a good program, you put the patient in the center of the things, the people you serve, they are the most important, then I think funds will come to you if you are doing good.
Absolutely. It's putting the people at the center of the intervention program. That's what I learned from each of your submission. You know, with this, I know, you know, we have a little bit more time. You know, if we quickly, if you want to ask questions, anyone from the audience, we have just time for about 3 and 4. You could just speak loudly and I'll translate that question to who are you speaking to? Keep your question very short so that we can get more time for the answer.
Sir, you yourself mentioned that the 80% of the farmers are having a low small holding of less than 2 acres. What I understand is that drip irrigation really requires, borewell pumps, etc. So how many of these small farmers really have borewell pumps? My own experience had been, pretty humbling that most of them...
The question is how many?
How drip irrigation, which is the primary focus of bringing productivity in farms, is supported, because that requires borewell pumps to provide the water.
How about we take a couple of questions and we have our panelists answer that? Yes, sir. Keep it very short.
Biggest, this is to Ms. Sherry, OpAsha. The biggest problem with the TB control programs in our country has been the programs have been overlooking the impact of zoonotic tuberculosis. So we are, as an experimental basis, we have been trying to assess the impact of this transmission of tuberculosis from animals to humans, which is huge. And the government people and then the whole of the program, they are refusing to look into this aspect because of several other things.
How are you planning to control effective control?
Can
if you are planning to, if not, then
integrated
it's okay.
Approach.
Right. Other questions, please? Yes, sir. Maybe, last question. We will be meeting, all of our speakers are available after 4, I hope, if someone wants to meet. Please do let the registration desk know.
Madam, I come from Bellary district. Related to this excretia subject, I want to give a small information. We had done a project which what eradicate the system. Time being, we had done eco sanitation from which.
Sir,
all who, the,
what your question is to which of the panelists?
Yes.
Which person? Mr. Wilson, sorry, I didn't hear.
So we had done that eco-sanitation from which human urine is converted as a fertilizer and all the villagers are using it. I request Ahmedabad Sarpanch to try this section in his village.
Sure. Thank you so much. We begin with Mr. Kulkarni and then...
Actually, I would like to say here that 90% of our farmers are small farmers having land less than 2 hectares. And why they are adopting is because of increase in productivity and income. And along with handholding and along with other products like tissue culture banana or tissue culture pomegranate or greenhouse technology, their productivity has increased many a times, 2 times, 3 times. And it's not necessary that we should have borewell. You can use it a farm pond, you can use a canal. Actually, we have a lot of models which I can describe, but because of short of time, I didn't go into deep. But if you are interested, we can tell. But it's not that only borewell is required. Any source of water is okay. Even if there is no source of water, we have implemented in 13 African countries where they use bucket, but using drip to save the water.
I would absolutely agree with the gentleman who spoke of an holistic approach towards tuberculosis. So TB, you cannot do TB just by treating. You have to do education, counseling, the entire spectrum, only then there can be an impact. And one of the things in the holistic approach, as you have rightly mentioned, sir, is advocacy with the government. From day one, I have been part of a group that does advocacy not just with the Indian government, but with the WHO, with CDC Atlanta, worldwide, to bring forth all other comorbidities and all other related issues. And this is one question that is being addressed in many, many fora across the world. And I'm very hopeful very soon the Indian government will take it up. Like the Indian government is now testing every TB patient for HIV, for diabetes, and now focusing on nutrition, which are the other aspects. So it has to be a totally wide spectrum of work, as you have rightly said.
Fantastic question. Because I quickly request each of you to just give a last, you know, advice, word, as up to what the future looks like. What is it that two, three things, one thing you want us to take away from your experience and wisdom that, you know, make us more effective in doing what we're doing.
About the eco-sanitation, it is a good model, but it is, we have to take it forward, but the country is now constructing the 12 crores of the toilets by 2019. So for that, we have to actually think that without having the drainage system and sewage system, if we have the toilets, again the 12 crores septic tanks will come. So who are going to clean the septic tanks that we have to develop? And eco-sanitation is good, that model, green toilets and all. Even Indian Railway is supposed to implement that, because in railway stations also you will be noticing that the human excreta, when the train stops, it falls on the track, and people definitely they have to clean in everywhere. And railway also had a different models, nothing model has succeeded so far, and now they are going for the DRDO, some other new model. So that also, I don't think that model will be feasible for the railways, and every financial year they will say that 500 coaches they are converting. And you may be aware that Indian Railways has 1,76,000 railway coaches. So, in that manner, if you convert, then we can think about that. But my humble submission is, there are the many models, many innovations, many active participation, very much required for the sanitation in the country. That is also is linked with the health, and it is also linked with the dignity and self-respect, and the life of the many scavengers.
Absolutely. So, thank you so much for that message, Mr. Wilson. Chetna, what do you want to leave our audience with?
So, when you said like how you look at the future, actually we are looking at impacting 1 million women entrepreneurs by 2020. When I say that, what I mean is that, you know, in this country, what works, when while working in rural areas, I saw that why women start businesses with so much of challenge? Why farmer would, you know, continue doing farming with so much of challenge? And what can, the one thing what keeps them going or what can keep them going is, I saw, is the pride. The pride, if you get the pride with Mandeshi, I saw that women are banking with Mandeshi because they're so proud of being Mandeshi. We are Mandeshi Bank. So that pride, and which I look for same pride on the investor side. When I say that, what I mean is, it's not grant. It's not, it's an investment with pride, which you are going to get the return. And when I say that, I'm also saying that there is a lot of innovation going on in financial sector, not just cashless. There's much more. We are setting up an alternative investment fund where investors can invest. So with the returns, there is a pride. So that pride can bring the money. Thank you.
गांव में सब कुछ हो सकता है, ऐसा नहीं कि मेट्रो सिटी में ही हो सकता है. गांव में वो सारी चीजें हो सकती है जो एक शहर एक अर्बन फैसिलिटी में हो सकती है. भारत कल भी सोने की चिड़िया थी, भारत आज भी सोने की चिड़िया.
I'll talk a bit about social entrepreneurs. I think we're a much maligned lot. And if you see social entrepreneurs, many of them are very highly qualified. They are lawyers, they are bankers, they are, well, CEOs. And they have stepped out of their ivory towers to serve the poorest of the poor, which is not an easy task. And they have to face a lot of criticism. People laugh at them. They have to put their own money, their savings of a lifetime go, as happened in my case. Yeah, people who are sitting on the dice here. So I have only one small word of advice. Don't lose heart. Have courage. Have compassion in your heart. And I think each person who's sitting on the dais today is serving with a lot of compassion. This is how the model builds up. If you have compassion, you're focused on results. And the happiness comes when you get your results. A patient is fully treated with TB. One of our patients was a little girl in an orphanage, and she was being thrown out. A 12-year-old child on the streets of Delhi would have died. We saw to it, she was kept in the orphanage, she recovered, she was kept in isolation for 2 months. And we pressurized the owner of the orphanage, you have to keep her here. You like it or not, we'll get you fired from your job. So these are little things, the good results, the happiness you see in the eyes of people who are saving, who are being lifted out of a certain social status, the farmers getting better, the villages getting better. I think all this is what keeps
absolutely
us going.
I think compassion comes first, and then comes strategy and skill and everything. That's what, you know, Chetna ji also talked about, the pride, the dignity, and then, you know, Manshi ji, to everything is possible. So I think with this optimism, compassion, and that pride, you know, Kulkarni ji, you have to give us more than a word, because you're really like a corporation. So first, we want you in sandbox. Number two, what is it that, you know, people sitting here who are running enterprise, is it an incremental increase always? I know I'm imposing my question, but you have, or what is that aspiration could be like? And because you're really a model in terms of what a social enterprise could do. So what is it that 2-3 things they should really keep their focus on?
Yeah. First of all, I would like to say that there is a role to play for corporates and private companies. They can become change agents, like what Himanshu has done. Why not corporates do that? You know, selling just product is not enough. Many of the corporate just, they concentrate on quarter to quarter profits, you know. I mean, that should not be the intention. If you are serving in an integrated manner.
We are too focused.
Yeah.
And we are not focused at all sometimes.
Yeah.
Or maybe we can have more focus. So I think there's something to learn from that corporate sector.
Yeah.
That even we could, you know, be more.
No, they should become change agents. That is what I would like to say here. And then only, you know, they have a lot of power, professional approach, knowledge. So why not to use it for changing society? Mindset, as rightly said by Wilson also, changing mindset is difficult. Here, the changing mindset of the farmer for adopting new technology. I mean, it's not an easy job. You have to do a lot of hand-holding. And I think agriculture business companies like us should do that hand-holding. And unless that is done, unless farmer prospers, I don't think India can prosper.
Absolutely.
I just want to say that last just 1 month I had a very difficult time, and I went to the Kargil petrol pump in Ahmedabad, and there the 3 people, they died in the sewer line. The just second day I went there, and I was there sitting there and talking to the family members. One just a small girl came and she want to talk to me. I don't know why. And she said like this. Then I said, what happened? Main ek baat bolna. Main bola kya? What? I want to become a doctor. Father died just 2 days before and she want to become the doctor. So I could not understand. I said, very good, and I have given the shake, and I said that you want to make your mother happy, you want to become the doctor. She said no. I said, you want to serve the everybody and get the more money and construct the house. Their house is very small. She said no. I said, then what? We went to government hospital, taken my daddy, and he was just talking to us without able to communicate much. He's taking the long breath, and there was in the stretcher, and there were, everybody was running. My mother went to call the doctors, nurses and everybody. And I was holding my father, and father was holding my hand, and he was unable to speak. After 4 hours, nobody has done, and my father has taken a long breath. And later, I don't know, my mother came and started crying that my father died. I want to become a doctor. I want to save such a people nowhere in the country. So I want to become a doctor. I felt really, there is no words for me. I feel the corporates and the well-wishers, we have to support such girls to come up in the country. Really, they have to become the doctors to save the many and many.
Thank you so much. Absolutely an inspiring panel. With this, we ending this session. We have much more, of course, to learn from each of the panelists. You know, Mr. Jain, Mr. Kulkarni saying that the largest irrigation company, but you're only reaching 2% of the farmers. I think that really sets the benchmark for most of us here who think that, you know, we are doing well. And as they said in the morning, that scaling, but what is that benchmark? So what is that percentage they are scaling to? Is it scaling significantly or we are scaling effectively? These are the two things we would keep talking about in the rest of the day and tomorrow. I request all of you to, you know, be there and bring your thoughts and ideas on in the panels. With this, thank you very much. We would like to present quickly a little token of gift from all of us here at EF. Thank you so much.